introduction. Thank you to my colleague, Imelda Daimler, and also to the colleagues at the Philippine Institute for Development Studies for creating this forum for us to have comprehensive and, I think, highly significant conversations. The theme that I want to address this morning is really the question of regulation viewed from the bottom. What are the rights that are owed to citizens when states and other regulatory actors create regulatory systems? So typically when we think about regulation, we use it as a synonym for law. We talk about administrative law and process, we talk about delegated legislation, the local government power to make rules locally. We also talk about review, independent regulatory agencies, but also the review role that courts have in ensuring that regulation is legal and that regulators are accountable. Another way in which regulation is commonly used and was used extensively in our conversation yesterday is as a way of constraining the market or as a barrier to market entry. So all of the OECD work that's been referenced in our conference thus far, which has a focus on trade and investment, is really focusing on regulation as a way of opening markets for greater trade and investment, and focusing on the way in which regulation affects foreign investors. We see that reflected quite strongly in the World Bank's Doing Business report. So in the latest report, last year, June 2016, we see that the Philippines is sitting at around the 99 level out of 190 countries surveyed, and we see Australia is considerably higher in the top band, around 15. So one of the things that's being measured in the World Bank's Doing Business metrics is the ease of doing business. How many regulatory constraints are there on setting up a business, on employing people for that business? How easy is it to disestablish a business through insolvency, and so forth? And those measures are from the point of view of the foreign investor. This also becomes particularly relevant now that the ASEAN economic community has come into being. So a great deal of multilateral effort and focus is now on harmonising regulations within the ASEAN community. And that of course then leads to what I'll call the deregulation discourse, much promoted by our colleagues, the economists, who are very much focused on transaction costs and inefficiencies. In most cases a little less focused on the distributive effects of deregulating or about the social costs of deregulating and what protections are owed citizens in countries where regulations are being wound back. We also think about regulation as a penalty or an enforcement mechanism. And it's interesting that the World Justice Project, which annually publishes a rule of law index, is now looking at regulatory enforcement as a measurement of rule of law. In this particular index, the Philippines is sitting around the middle. It's ranked 70 out of the 113 countries surveyed. Australia is ranked 11 out of 113. But both Australia and the Philippines have actually dropped in their rankings in 2016. So this is a measure of the capability of the state to actually enforce regulations, but also to make them public and to make them intelligible to the population. I apologise for the size of this particular diagram, but you can see that regulatory enforcement is sitting as one of the factors that now makes up the rule of law index. So the classical concerns about regulations were the kinds of things that we were talking about yesterday, and here also mentioned by Professor Sharon Friel today, the question of regulatory coherence, whether regulations made across different sectors are actually compatible, whether they're linked up. Dr. Gilberto Lanto has done a lot of work on this in relation to the Philippines. And he's advocating that the Philippines introduces a regulatory management system, which is one way of getting that regulatory coherence. He also suggests that the Philippines would benefit from having an agency that's charged with routine review and reform of regulation. The Philippines has enormous regulatory capacity, but at the moment it doesn't have either of those design features. Policymakers, of course, are also concerned with whether regulation is efficient. And so in Australia at the moment, we have a lot of government enthusiasm for what they call cutting red tape, removing regulations that are outdated or that are superfluous. And we know that within the OECD, there's considerable enthusiasm for what Jacobs and Associates have called the regulatory guillotine, where you come in and simply remove in one cut all of the regulations that are deemed to be inefficient, not helpful for business, or out of date. It's also normal to do cost-benefit analysis before you introduce regulations and to do a regulatory impact analysis to see in advance what the consequences, intended and unintended, of new regulation might be. The other thing that states typically focus on is enforcement capacity, whether you have capable bureaucracies and independent agencies. And we noted that in the panel earlier this morning. What I'd like to draw attention to is some of the thinking in Australia around what we'll call next generation regulation. So as Sharon Friel explained earlier, when we think of regulation at the School of Regulation and Global Governance, REGNET, at the Australian National University, we think of regulation as being a way of shaping the course of events. One popular example of that definition of regulation is the book Nudge that came out in 2009. Nudge was co-authored by Richard Thaler and Cass Sunstein. Thaler, of course, has just won the Nobel Prize for Economics for his contributions to behavioural economics. Cass Sunstein is a very prominent legal, academic and public policy thinker in the US. He was President Obama's regulatory policy advisor. And what those co-authors are pointing to in Nudge is the idea that regulation can be a matter of design. It doesn't need to involve law necessarily. It can harness social norms, social ordering, design and architecture, and it harnesses behavioural economics. And the very famous example from the book Nudge that you might be familiar with and that's highly relevant for the discussion that we've just had about diet is the question of how you approach the buffet. So the argument that's put in Nudge is that when you're setting up a buffet and you're giving people a choice about what to eat for lunch, the smart thing to do is to put the healthy food at the beginning of the buffet. And the example is you put a bowl of apples very early in the buffet and you put it down low so that people can pick up the apple easily. The idea is that you're hungry, you're ready to make a food choice, and so you still have the power to choose, but by design, we're going to put the healthy food in a place that's convenient for you. And so by the time you get to the end of the buffet and you're considering the flan or the cake, you're already full because you've already had the apple. So please consider that as you approach the regulatory problem of lunch. The Australian contribution to this new generation of regulatory thinking is what we call responsive regulation. And this is a concept developed by our colleague John Braithwaite in cooperation with a number of other scholars, principally Ian Ayres. And the idea here is that when we're thinking of regulating a social problem or regulating a sector, the first question for the regulator, whether that's a state regulator or a non-state regulator, is what is the capacity of the those being regulated to first of all regulate themselves. So before we decide to do an intervention, before we decide to stipulate what the penalties are going to be, before we decide to force people into behavioural change, let's look first at their capacity to effect this change themselves. It's important to note that the law enforcers here are not just state agencies, but they also include civil society and corporations. So a paradigm example was Marion's discussion of Grab in the panel ahead of ours today. So Grab in some jurisdictions is already co-producing regulation, co-producing public policy because of the technical expertise and the design capabilities that they bring to the table, and also because of their capability to self-regulate. What's important about responsive regulation is that it certainly pays attention to efficiency, to cost benefit, but at the core it has normative values. So it asks whose benefit, at whose cost, what is the democratic effect of the regulation on the citizen or those who are being regulated. And the way that this is expressed is through what we call the regulatory pyramid. So the idea is that you start at the base of the pyramid and you assume that most people are virtuous actors. Most people do the right thing most of the time. And so it's easy to persuade people to self-regulate. You simply explain what the problem is, explain what you want them to do, and for the most part they will do it. If they don't, the way in which you nudge them or influence them is through restorative justice. You have a conversation with them and explain why you need them to behave in this way and what the consequences will be if they don't. The second group of people you need to influence are what we call the rational actors. And they will only do the right thing if there's an incentive, if there's something in it for them, or if the cost of not doing the right thing is quite high. So those are the folks that you direct some deterrence at. You show them very clearly what the penalties for non-compliance will be. And then at the tip of the pyramid, we have what we call the incompetent or the intentional actors. These are the bad guys. And it doesn't matter what you say to them, they will still do the wrong thing. They are intending to be non-compliant. And so what you want to do with them is incapacitate them through a criminal penalty, or if it's a corporation, the ultimate sanction for a corporation is to dissolve it. You simply declare it to be completely outside the bounds of law. So what's important here is that you're putting most of your effort into the tip of the pyramid, but you really only have to put a limited amount of effort there because you've only got a limited number of really bad actors. So pyramid regulation has a lot of benefits. It's less costly, it's less coercive, because the more respectful options come first. We have a conversation first and we try persuasion before we escalate to tougher possibilities or tougher sanctions. It's more legitimate because citizens feel listened to and they have a role in that conversation. They have a chance to push back against unjust rules or laws that they think are unreasonable. It's procedurally fair because everybody understands that after the dialogue, if there isn't compliance, then we will move to coercion. And therefore, compliance is more likely. The other big efficiency dividend from pyramid regulation is that it avoids what we call system overload. That is, if you have too many penalties, it's highly likely that your procedural systems, for example, your criminal justice system, will get really clogged up because you're trying to prosecute every single little case. This way, the system keeps clear and the resources are free to just focus on the tip of the pyramid, the really serious cases. And so this reduces exploitation by rational actors, because a rational actor will look at congestion in a criminal justice system and say, the chances of me being caught are very slim, and therefore I'm going to continue to be non-compliant. In this system, you signal hard to the rational actors that they will get caught. Now, we know that the pyramid is a good system design, and yet we keep having regulatory failure. I don't think I need to explain the cartoon on the right. I think that's fairly familiar to this audience. We would think of extrajudicial killing typically as a law and justice problem. But I'm going to suggest to you that it's actually a regulatory problem. This is the complete opposite of the pyramid. This is a big expenditure of time, effort, bribes that is illegitimate and that comes without any prior effort at persuasion or dialogue. So it's a classic example of true regulatory failure that will have and is continuing to have big reputational costs for this current government. On the left is a regulatory failure by Australia. It looks pretty innocent. It looks like a credit card. This is a stored value card. So it's a cashless card that our government has imposed on rural communities in remote parts of Australia. Those rural communities have very high numbers of Indigenous people, Aboriginal Australians. They also have non-Indigenous Australians, so white Australians also live in those communities. And the idea with the cashless card is that if you're entitled to a government allowance or a government benefit, you would normally receive that in cash. But now you're going to receive it through this cashless card. And the effect of that is that you will be unable to spend that money on products like alcohol. Also, because there's no cash involved, you can't share your income with members of your family. It also means that that income can't be stolen by members of your family. So the intentions of rolling out this card were good. They had a public health intention and also a welfare intention so that people receiving benefits wouldn't be put under a lot of pressure by family members who would then take the cash and go away and spend it in unwise ways. But the unintended consequence of this card is that it can only be used in those communities. You can't use this card in Sydney or Melbourne or Canberra. So if you need to travel, or a member of your family needs to travel to receive medical attention in the city, you effectively can't do that because you have no cash. You can't use this card for that travel or that medical care. One of the reasons we created that regulatory failure was because we didn't consult enough with the communities. So this is now a very, very controversial measure. And I offer it simply to show that the problem is a complex one, how to get good health and well-being in remote communities who are very disadvantaged is a complex problem, but we have not taken a very helpful regulatory approach. One of the ideas that's really integral to this new generation of regulatory thinking is networked regulation. So where the state regulators have failed or lack capacity, what they really need to do is enroll other actors to help. That might be internationally, other states, could be NGOs, certification organisations, faith-based organisations, citizens, the middle class, corporations. The idea here is that regulation is everybody's business. And all kinds of organisations and individuals can be and are regulators. And they need to be part of the regulatory conversation with government, and they need to be part of the regulatory design. And this is simply a way of diagramming out the way in which they relate to the regulatory pyramid. We'll skip over that. Let me close by pointing out that something that has happened internationally is that in the development of the Sustainable Development Goals, we now have regulation and regulatory quality built in as one of the ways in which participating states are going to be measured. So Sustainable Development Goal 16 deals with law and justice and peace. So it's designed to promote peaceful and inclusive societies. But you'll notice that the next line immediately refers to effective, accountable, and inclusive institutions. And when we go down a bit more deeply into what makes up SDG 16, we see at least four places where regulation is explicitly referenced. So the quality of regulation and the quality of its responsiveness is now being linked with rule of law, it's being linked with peace building, and it's certainly under the umbrella of SDG 16, and it's something that everyone, including the Philippines and Australia, will be measured on. The progress at the moment in 2017 points to things like the homicide rate in some countries, opaque, burdensome and inefficient regulations, in particular the way in which those foster opportunities for corruption, so that's the conventional definition of regulation. But note also that independent national human rights institutions are also a measure of the regulatory health of a country. And I don't think I need to note for this audience that the Philippines at the moment is particularly vulnerable in this measure, both in relation to the human rights institution, but also in relation to the judiciary. So the point here is that we're all on the hook, we're all going to be evaluated on this internationally, and this kind of responsive regulation is now very much connected with and part of the way in which we measure other more conventional qualities like rule of law. Thank you.